Good morning, everyone. My name is Darren St. George, and welcome to another Chit Chat with Sal St. George. We're talking about Burns and Allen today, and we're very excited for this one. This is a conversation that we started last week. Burns and Allen were mentioned, and we thought it was just worth continuing the conversation today. So thank you for signing on. We are going to be doing some unique things today. We have a poll set up to see what subjects you're also interested in to learn a few more. If you have any trouble during the entire conversation, just send me a private message and I'll be happy to help in any way I can. If you don't hear me or if you have trouble with the video, just let me know. Again, we do ask that everybody keeps their microphones and their video turned off just so we can more easily hear Sal and what's going on. But we always encourage your questions, so please send those in the chat window. Send them publicly, that's fine. We can share our questions with everyone and we'll start our conversation. As always, we have Sal St. George with us today. He is a professor across Long Island, a published author, an acclaimed writer, and has 35 years of experience producing, writing, directing, and creating amazing historic entertainment across the tri-state area, including places for, like, you may have heard, Disney World, Busch Gardens, SeaWorld. So we're all excited to hear from him. Sal, are you with us there? Are you with us today? There we go.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. I can't tell you how gratifying it is to hear the different members talking to one another and sharing their information. That is wonderful. I also want to welcome, I think Seaford Library has offered this to many of their people. And if you're from Seaford or the surrounding area, welcome aboard. I'm hoping you have a good time today. How are you doing, Darren?
I'm doing fine. Yeah, I'm just watching, keeping track of everybody that's popping in. We still have a few stragglers, but that's all right. Okay. It's coming along.
Now, for all of you that are new to us, Darren, as you can already guess, is my son. But more importantly, he gave us a beautiful grandson 3 years ago. And his wife, who's probably sitting really nearby listening to all this, is expecting her second child, and the baby is due in July. We're right around the corner. So this is a heck of a world to bring a youngster into, but that's the way the cards are falling right now. I hope she's okay. She's all right, Tay?
She's doing great. Yeah. Telling a pregnant woman who's in her last trimester that she has to stay in one place, calm and collected, and not worry about going out. You know, she's pretty happy. So it works for her.
Good. All right. So let's get down to business. The first thing I want to mention is last week I spoke about several books that I was reading for my research. And right now, many of you may have already seen my I Love Lucy lecture, which really focuses on how the show was put together and that entire scenario. And I only cover I Love Lucy. But now I'm putting together a brand new lecture, and it's Lucy Without Desi. And in that regard, what I'm doing is I want to show you two books that I'm already getting. There is one other one, but it's not here yet. This is the first one. It's called Laughs, Luck, and Lucy. I know there's a lot of librarians out there, so maybe somebody has one of these. But this is written by Jess Oppenheimer, who was their executive producer, and he was with them from the very, very beginning when they put the show together. He has a lot of background on how they got together and how they put the show together. So I'm real excited about this book, just got it. So this covers the beginning of the Lucy life, the Lucy story. And then the second book I want to show you is called I Loved Lucy. And it's written by Lee Tannen. And during the last 10 years of her life, she befriended Lee. And he accompanied her all around wherever she went, to special functions, to speaking engagements, to TV shows. And he describes his life with Lucy during those last 10 years. What I'm specifically interested in, and he covers it well, Lucy had a very short-lived series toward the end of her life. She, I think she was about 70 or 72 at the time, and she did a show called Life with Lucy. And the show was really poorly received. It went right off the air, and it was, for her, a huge scandal in her life. She felt that the American public had stopped loving Lucy, and he was there as an eyewitness, so I'm excited to be reading those particular chapters. So those are the things I'm reading this week. Darren will put it up online, and you can check it out if you want to pick up a copy from Amazon.
Yep, you're already set. I shared the link in the chat window with everyone.
Good. And if anybody has a question on anything, keep it to yourself. I'm busy. Okay, so let's see what we're going to talk about today. We're talking about George Burns and Gracie Allen. You can't get any better. And they came from a world that, best way to describe it is, young people today do not have the good fortune that they had in those days to be able to work in vaudeville. And vaudeville trained you for everything. You had to sing, you had to dance, you had to tap dance, you had to do comedy, sometimes you did dramatic scenes. Vaudeville was a great proving ground. And now George, we'll get into his life. Let's start with him first. George loved entertaining. Let's go backwards. Born on the Lower East Side of New York, one of 12 children. When he's 9 years old, his father passes away, and all the kids go out, as they did in those days, to get jobs. This is prior to child labor laws. And he's taking any kind of work he can get. And he's working as a shoe shine boy. He's working in all different forms of entertainment. Street work. And he ends up working in a syrup factory, pouring chocolate syrup into bottles. It was in the basement of an old building, and the room was occupied by four boys, young boys. They were all probably about 12 years old at this point, between 9 and 12. And they would be downstairs in this gloomy basement working on filling the bottles. And if you might remember what those basements were like in Brooklyn at that time, they had little windows that would be where people from outside could look in and see what you were doing. And being George Burns, who was actually Nat Birnbaum at this point in time, to avoid anybody getting bored, he said, let's start singing songs. And that's what they would do. So the four boys formed a little quartet between the four of them. And as they were working, they were singing songs of the time period. And people would stick their heads into the window and hear them singing. And George realized the people outside were really enjoying what they were doing. And he said, guys, we just formed a peewee quartet. We're going up on the streets and we're going to sing out there. And that's what they did. They started singing on street corners. They were early street performers. One of his favorite places was the Staten Island Ferry, going back and forth. They would make a lot of money just doing their singing. He stayed in entertainment from that point on. He started going into vaudeville. And now he's in his early 20s. And his acts are so bad. Oh, he always had to have a partner. That's the other part of this. When you hear about the Pee Wee Quartet, yeah, he had to have these guys with him. Going into vaudeville, he always felt he had to have a partner. So consequently, what he would do is audition young women, and they would be his partner. Oddly enough, many times the act was so bad that he would change the name of the act so that the vaudeville houses and the agents wouldn't know it was him, so that they would rebook him into the house. So he's working back and forth. At one point, he gets one partner, Harriet was her name, they worked so well together that they were offered a 6-month contract to travel around the country in the vaudeville circuit doing their act. The only problem is Harriet's father didn't like the idea of his 17-year-old daughter traveling around with this actor type. So to make sure that they didn't lose the booking, George marries her. They work for 6 months. They never consummate the marriage. And then after they're done with the tour, they break up, and that's the last he ever sees of her. He's continually looking for a partner. Now, we're going to travel from New York, across the country to San Francisco, where Gracie Allen grew up with her family, and she and her three sisters formed a dance group. Believe it or not, they were dancers, and they were Irish, and they called themselves the Four Colleens. And they would travel around doing all these shows together in vaudeville houses in San Francisco and the surrounding area. They're doing very well until one of her sisters meets a young guy. They fall in love. She drops out, and now it's the Three Colleens. The Three Colleens are still touring until one of them, again, meets somebody, marries him, and now it's the Two Colleens. And before you know it, Gracie is by herself. But she wants to stay in the entertainment business, so she ends up deciding to go to New York to try to make it in the big time. When she gets here, she's talking to a lot of people, and the name of George Burns comes up. By the way, he changed his name. He saw the name Burns. It was a coal truck that sold coal. And it was Burns Coal Company, and he just took the name Burns. He liked it, and that's where George Burns came from. Gracie hears about this young comic by the name of George Burns that's looking for a partner. She auditions for him, and you know how they say that it's love at first sight? Well, they met each other, and Gracie did not like him at all. Didn't like him at all. He was cocky. He was young. He was brash. He said that if we're going to form an act, he's going to be the lead. It was going to be a 60-40 split. He was going to be the comic. He was going to be the main comic on the show, and she would be the straight man. He even dressed like a burlesque comic in those days with a loud jacket and big tie, funny hat. But he found out something during one of their first performances. He wasn't getting any laughs. But every time Gracie would ask him a question, they would get laughs. And he was smart enough to realize they had to switch parts. And from that point on, Burns and Allen, by the way, usually the straight man's name comes first. Burns and Allen, Abbott and Costello, you just go through them all and you'll see that it's usually the straight man's name is first. They were considered more important. The important thing about this, George and she got together and they started touring together in 1922, and one of their first engagements was at the Hall Street Theater, which was located in Hill Street Theater. It was located in Newark, New Jersey. They met in 1922 working together, and then 1929 they finally got married. By the way, their best man at the wedding was another young comic by the name of Jack Benny. And that's how far back the relationship between George Burns and Jack Benny goes. Let me just divert a little bit. George had a lifelong relationship with Jack, where he was always pulling practical jokes on him because Jack was an easy mark. It was easy to crack him up. It was easy to make him laugh. And I'll give you an example. They went to Chasen's for one of their dinners, and he and George are sitting there having dinner, and George says to Jack, you know, we've been coming to this restaurant for years. You would think once Chasen's would pay for our dinner. And Jack said, well, it's a business. He's got to make his money. He's got to pay his rent. And George says, yeah, I think they should pay at least for one dinner. I'll tell you what we're going to do. When the waiter comes with our check, when the waiter comes without a check, I'm going to grab the check and I'll say, I'll pay the check. And then you grab it from me, Jack, and you say, no, I'll pay the check. And I'll take it back and I'll say, no, I'll pay the check. And they go back and forth and they say, the waiter will probably say, look, don't worry about it. We'll pay the check this time. And Jack says, you think that's going to happen? He says, trust me. The waiter comes, puts the check down. George grabs it, says, I'll pay the check. Jack grabs it and he says, no, I'll pay the check. And George says, okay. That's the kind of relationship they had between them. That's the kind of relationship they had. And they were always pulling pranks. Jack was the best man at George and Gracie's wedding. Here's another story. Jack tells Mary Livingston, who he was already with at that point, I'm going to call up George and Gracie and congratulate them while they're on their honeymoon. And he dials the phone number at the hotel that George and Gracie are staying at. George picks up the phone. He hears Jack's voice. He says, send up some fresh eggs. And he hangs up. Jack picks up the phone again, dials. George answers, and a pot of coffee. Please, a pot of coffee. And he hangs up. Jack is befuddled. He calls again. George says, bacon. I want bacon with those eggs. Hangs up again. The reason was he knew every time he hung up on Jack, Jack was falling on the floor laughing because he knew he was being bamboozled by his best friend. I'm going to fast forward a little bit just because we don't have that much time, but I really want to fill this in with the story of Jack and George. Late in life, Jack was hired to make a movie, and it was called The Sunshine Boys. And originally it was Jack and Red Skelton. And then Red Skelton dropped out. And then it was Jack and Phil Silvers. And then Phil Silvers dropped out. And eventually they got around to getting one of the top box office names. At that time, he was too young for the part, but they aged him with makeup, and Walter Matthau ended up in the part. They're making the movie. They just started, and Jack is feeling discomfort. He goes to the doctors, and he has cancer. And unfortunately, he knows his time is short, and he calls up his best friend, and he says to George, he says, George, I want you to do this movie for me. I'm never going to make it. And George says, no, he's being optimistic. You're going to make it. You're going to finish it. It's going to be your best role. He says, no, trust me, George, I really want you to do this role for me. He ends up doing the role. Jack passes on, and George ends up winning the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor in a Motion Picture. At that point, at the age of 80, he was the oldest living recipient to receive Academy Award. And that stayed as a record until, I think it was around 1983-84, when Jessica Tandy won for Driving Miss Daisy. So we just did a little side switch there. Darren, do we have any questions popping up?
No, we don't have any questions yet, but if anybody does have one, please just send it in the chat. You can also raise your hand. There's a little animation for reactions at the bottom of your screen. You can click on reactions and you can send a little emoji to see how you're doing if you have something you'd like to share.
Darren, can you put up some of those slides that I put together for you?
Yeah, you bet. Let's do it right now.
Okay, let's go to the next. As it says, they conquered. Okay, here is a very, very early photographs of them when they started out in vaudeville. On the right, the larger picture is them doing the trademark routine that they created called Lamb Chops. That's their trademark routine. George already had lost all his hair at this point. He was already bald at this point. And then from then on, once he got into movies and all on stage, he got the wig. Can we go to the next one? From there, they go on to the radio. Now, radio was custom made for these two. There was no question about it. Gracie established her character even more so on radio. And it was great because they, let me just give you a couple of Gracie Allen jokes. Hold on one second here. One of the running gags that they had was that she would always talk about her brother. And she had great stories about him. And one of the stories that she had was that she just got a letter from her brother, and her brother said, "You're not going to recognize your niece because since the last time you saw her, she has three legs." And George says, "Your niece has three legs?" And she says, "Yeah. My brother said that last time, since the last time I saw her, she grew another foot." There's a great story on their TV show. There was a great, I love Gracie Allen's illogical logic. By the way, George wrote all her routines. Once they got into radio, naturally, they had writers, but he oversaw everything. He was very protective of her image. He was very protective of how she was presented. Even when he was on stage and he had his trademark cigar, he would make sure that the wind, even if it was in a theater, wasn't blowing in her direction so that she wouldn't get smoke in her face while she was working. Great line. He walks into the house and he sees this beautiful bouquet of flowers. And he says to Gracie, "Where did you get the flowers?" And she says, "Don't you remember, George? You said when I visit Clara in the hospital to be sure to take her flowers? Well, when she wasn't looking, I did." Those are the great illogical logic that Gracie had. Terrific stuff.
I'm going to cut in one second. We do have a quick question. Just from Joseph, he's curious, if George and Harriet were doing so well, why did George drop her?
Family issues. And it was personality. Yeah. You know what? When you're working with a partner, that partner has to be in tune with you on stage. You have to be able to work so well together. And all the great teams, you can talk about them, even if they had difficulties, like Martin and Lewis and Abbott and Costello and the rest of them, even if they had difficulties, once they hit that stage, there was this camaraderie between the two of them that they could finish each other's thought, not even words. They would know if the comic left the routine to ad lib, the good straight man would be able to bring them back in again. And Dean Martin was fantastic at reining in Jerry Lewis. A lot of people don't realize that. Same thing with the Smothers Brothers, Dick Martin. Dick Smothers always was able to rein in Tommy Smothers. When you watch them, watch the straight man for a change. Usually everybody is fixated on the comic because they're so funny. But watch the straight man on how they control the rhythm of the entire routine. Where was I?
That's really good. We have, you know, talking about all of these comics, this is a good opportunity. We're trying something today, and I'm going to launch a quick poll that you should be able to see on your screens. And it's just, we're just asking what you would like to chat about, given the option. Would you like to see, people are already responding. Are you interested in learning more about male comedy teams or female comedy teams? And apparently you are off to the races, and female comedy teams has taken the lead.
We have 12 to 4
going for female comedy teams. We have male comedy teams still holding at 15 for female comedy teams. Do I hear 16? 16 for female comedy teams. That's 64%. Male comedy teams are coming back. We have 10 for male comedy teams. It's a 60-30 split. Oh, here we go, 60-40 split. Male comedy teams coming in at the end. Here we have it, and it looks 60-40 for female comedy teams is where we are settling in. Oh, my goodness.
Awesome. Right. Hey, that was pretty cool.
That was amazing. It looks like it works. All right, maybe we'll try this again in the future. Holy cow.
You know what you can ask them? Can you put another one in right now?
Take me a second.
Okay, no rush. But we were taking off next week. We were skipping next week because it's Memorial Day weekend. We know everybody's going out to the beaches and picnics. Yeah, right. So if you would like me to be here next week, next Monday at 10 a.m., to do comedy teams, I will be happy to do that for you. So Darren, take a little tab on that.
Yep, you bet. You know, we can do this even faster. If you are available, you can just write yes in the comments, or you can just click yes as a little reaction. If you're available, thank you, Alyssa, already. Wow, here we go. And there it is. It looks like so far people are available. While they're writing in, Dad, we have one more question here about Gracie. Was she engaged to somebody else when she met George?
Absolutely. She was engaged to somebody in San Francisco, came to New York, and George was persistent. You know, you got to think about it. You know, he knew he had the right partner, personally and professionally. He knew she was the one for him, and he was loyal to her to the end. There's a great story about he fooled around, and she caught him, and he was so guilt-ridden that he bought her a beautiful Chinese vase to put in their living room as a gift. Several months later, George is walking by the living room, and he hears Gracie talking to one of her girlfriends, and she says to her, "Gee, I wish George would go and have another affair. I'd like to get a matching vase to go on the other end of the cat." It's a great story.
Here we have a couple of questions for Gracie. Is there any truth, this comes from Steve, is there any truth to the story that Gracie wanted to retire, but George wanted to keep the show going?
Okay, you're ahead of us, so we'll get to that in a few minutes.
All right, then more questions, just curiosity about Gracie's bio and where she's coming from Joseph.
Gracie had a really good family life, very Irish, very Catholic. We're talking, this is for that time period, he was Jewish, she was Catholic, but they melded together perfectly. They raised their children Catholic. They adopted two children. By the way, her daughter did occasional spots on their TV show, but her son, Ronnie, was on quite a bit. Now, for the Honeymooner fans that are out there, there's an episode where Alice wants to go and do things like the neighbor's kids are doing, young kids, and it's the whole episode where they go roller skating. But prior to that, the young boy from upstairs comes down, and that is Ronnie Burns as a guest on the show. He was a guest on The Honeymooners. Let me take that a step further, because I don't know if people realize the relationship that George Burns had with Jackie Gleason. There's a great episode where Norton is doing a crossword puzzle. And as he's writing it, he goes, "Hey, Ralph, what's a three-letter word for bug?" And he said, and Ralph says, "Nat." N-A-T. And Alice says, "No, no, Jackie. No, Ralph. Nat is spelled G-N-A-T. And Norton says, "I don't know about that, Alice. I have a guy down at work that I work with, Nat Birnbaum, and he spells it N-A-T. Nat Birnbaum is George Burns' real name. So it's kind of funny that they have these references to George Burns if you go through the episodes.
We have a question from Nina. She read that Gracie's father left when she was 5, and she never spoke to him again. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. Absolutely. Yep. And the funny thing, the mother, interesting story. She was complaining to her daughter, Gracie, that all her daughters were virgins when they got married, because she was upset that she was traveling with George. And she said, all my daughters were virgins before they got married. And Gracie said, "Yeah, Mom, that's because they were all dogs." So her mother's reaction is the funny part. She said, they were sitting at the kitchen table having dinner, and she said, "Pass the salt." Now, the pass the salt was, I don't want to talk about this anymore. For decades, during their entire marriage, George and Gracie used pass the salt. George would come down, Gracie would look at the paper, and she said, "Did you see what was in Variety today about us?" And he said, Pastor Saul, meaning it was a bad review. He didn't want to hear about it. He wanted to talk about it. But they used Pastor Saul all the time, which was their way of saying, I don't want to talk about this. Let's just drop it now.
Oh, I like that. I like that. Yeah, speaking of which, let's pass the salt and look back at some of those pictures we had earlier. Let's continue moving forward.
Yeah. So. Yeah, we're spending a lot of time on.
That's okay. It's good. Okay. It's good information.
Okay, let's move to the next one. This next one is kind of interesting. This is in their early career, they made, I think it was 29 movies. And they worked with everybody from W.C. Fields and Rudy Valley, and Jack Benny was in several of their films. The one I want you to pay attention to is in the upper left-hand corner. It's called We're Not Dressing. It's one of the first movies I ever saw where I noticed who Burns and Allen were. But look at the cast on that movie. It's really interesting. Carol Lombard, Bing Crosby, Burns and Allen, Ethel Merman, Leon Errol, in a bit part, a very young Ray Milland, all in this film. And what's interesting about it, because it's on TCM all the time, it's a precursor to Gilligan's Island. They play a group of people that are stranded on a desert island, a secluded island, and how they survive. It's a comedy. It's funny. And Bing Crosby sings quite a few songs in it. Three of the songs from that movie ended up going on the charts in number one slots. Okay, let's go to the next one. All right, now, this one really interested me quite a bit. The Fred Astaire had made six movies already with Ginger Rogers. At this point, not that they were tired of each other or nothing like that at all, but they just wanted to take a break from each other. She went on to make The Women with Katharine Hepburn and Lucille Ball and quite a few others. And she was going into other directions. She ended up winning an Academy Award for Kitty Foyle. But when she dropped out of Damsel in Distress, Fred needed a dance partner. And the studio assigned him a very, very young, Joan Fontaine. The only thing that they didn't realize is Joan did not sing or dance. Not at all. So Fred very wisely took George and Gracie to be not only his comedy partners, but his dance partners. What? They dance? Can we go to the next slide?
Yeah, you bet. Also, there's a quick thing. It looks like somebody said that, Andrew says that Gracie looks pretty tiny. Was she?
Yeah, I think she was 4'11". Yeah. Okay, the next slide. Now, here they are rehearsing, the three of them. Now, here's what happened. George, being from Vaudeville, knew of a specific dance routine that he thought would be perfect for a Fred Astaire movie. And he went over to his house with Gracie. They demonstrated it. And then Fred said, I want this in our next film. You can go to the next slide. Here they are rehearsing it again. It was done with a brush, an old-fashioned brush that you use to dust off your clothing. And we have a clip of that right now. And I want you to show that. Is that okay, Darren?
Yeah, let's take a look. You know what? Let me...
just so you know, the purpose of this... George taught Fred Astaire how to dance this routine.
Here we go. And this was also the bonus clip that we sent out over email earlier.
Okay.
Take a quick look. Can you hear it all right?
Nope.
No, you can't hear it?
No.
Audio isn't coming through for some reason. It should. Oh, let's see here. Hang on. There we go. I know why. Let's start over. Here you go. I'll try one more time. Here we go. Yep, no sound. Let's do this. All right.
When you're watching this, watch how Gracie stays in character. She stays Gracie Allen. He stays as George Burns.
All right. Let's try that. any better? Do we have audio?
Yeah.
For the sake of time, we're gonna have to pause there.
Okay. But,
it's certainly it's impressive to see how proficient she was at dancing
and singing. Watch the movie Damsel in Distress. You'll see how she sings, she dances. Their abilities were far beyond what the TV show gave them an opportunity to do. It's very, very interesting. I really love that movie for that reason. I feel bad for Joan Fontaine. She said that movie put her career back 4 years because she got such bad reviews. She eventually was able to redeem herself because she did a lot of great movies after that. But that movie was a heartbreak for her because she felt she was overwhelmed. And she was only 19, by the way.
Stanley noticed that in one of the movies had Amos and Andy listed.
Yes.
They had two comedy teams on the same film?
Yeah, but it was like a big broadcast, so everybody had their own slot. Okay. It wasn't like a vaudeville show. They weren't all back-to-back.
All right, we're approaching 45 minutes talking so far about Burns and Allen, and I want to make sure that we talk about the clip from What's My Line.
Oh, yes. I'll just quickly mention, first of all, I love Steve Allen in it. You can see why he was so darn funny all the time. I had the good fortune of meeting him a couple of times, and he was just as gracious, as generous as you can imagine. We'll talk about him another time. But the reason I showed it is her sense of humor comes through with just one line. They do the whole thing silent, and then he says, okay, let's let them talk. And she says, don't say anything, George. Bam. She just nails the audience with that one moment. And she just steals the whole show. Okay, I do want to show the Gracie for President, if we can get to that.
Yeah, the clips, the images.
Yeah.
Yep.
What happened was, it was 1940, I believe. And FDR was running again, and they were a lot of comedians were doing mock campaigns, including Will Rogers, Eddie Cantor. They were all doing it. And okay, back there we go. But Gracie put together this surprise party instead of the Republican Party. She said, it was kind of interesting. She said, my father was a Republican. He was with the Republican Party. My mother was a Democratic Party. And when I was born, I was a surprise. So this is the surprise party. It caught on with the country. It culminated with a convention that she had, and over 8,000 people showed up to see Gracie Allen give her stump speech. The bottom line after that, she realized she was stealing too much attention away from the real candidates, and she canceled her campaign. And she said, I think it's time we started looking at the real story. We have a little bit of her campaign song, if you can click on that, Aaron.
Here we go.
Vote for Gracie, vote for Gracie. She's the best little skipper in the land. Vote for Gracie, vote for Gracie. Won't you please give this little girl a hand? That's me. Even big politicians don't know what to do. Gracie doesn't know either, but neither do you. So vote for Gracie to win the presidential race. 100 million strong. That's right, you can't go wrong. Vote for Gracie. Keep voting all day long.
So she campaigns, and even though she canceled her campaign, depending on what research you do, she either got several hundred votes or several thousand votes, but she did get write-in votes from her campaign. Okay, what's the last slide you have there?
Last one that we have for Burns and Allen. Here you go, put that up. Say yeah. Goodnight, Gracie.
Yeah. Now, the funny thing about it is she never said goodnight, Gracie. People think that he said, say goodnight, Gracie, and she said, goodnight, Gracie. No, she always just said goodnight, and then they would back off the way they look right there, and that was it. The comedy team that stole it was Rowan and Martin on Laugh-In every week. Dan Rowan would say goodnight, Dick, and he'd say goodnight, Dick, and that would be it. But Gracie Allen never said it.
All right. Okay.
I ran overtime on this one.
We did, and that's okay. I mean, everybody's still sticking around. It's great conversation and good stories that we want to learn more about. I would be remiss. I do want to mention one thing that happened this week and see if we can share a quick word about a favorite comedian, Fred Willard. Dad, did you hear about this?
Yeah, very sad. Funny man. He did a great job on Everybody Loves Raymond. But you know what? That was the culmination of a year, of a lifetime of experiences that he brought to that show. Terrific comic. The Best of Show, terrific movie about the dog contests. Check that one out if you just want to have a good laugh. And who doesn't right now want to have a good laugh? Thank you for tuning in. And let's do this again next Monday, and we'll keep it going as long as we're being held up in our homes. At least we can spend some time together and have a few laughs. Thank you so much for tuning in, everybody. And tell your friends about us. Let's get more people here.
Great. We'll see you soon. As always, you can follow us on Facebook to learn more and see what we have. We have other posts talking about Donald O'Connor here doing a tap dance number. You can also follow us at salstgeorge.com, where we have his calendar, and you can keep up to date with what lectures he has going on where, as well as, of course, our coffee and comedy, our chit-chats every Monday morning.
At 10 a.m., 10 a.m.
At 10 a.m., yes. Thank and everybody you. Wrote in the chat room, so we are confirmed for next week. It looks like everybody has time, so I'm happy to see that.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. So have a great afternoon.
Stay safe, stay healthy, stay positive.
Bye. Have a great day. Thank you.
Bye. You too.